Twilight, Book 1, Chapter 4, Invitations, Chapter Name. In my dreams, it was very dark, and dim light that was seems to be radiating from Edward's skin. I could not see his face, just his back, as he walked away from me, leaving me in the blackness. No matter how fast I ran, I could not catch up to him. No matter how loud I called, he never turned. Troubled, I woke up in the middle of the night and could not sleep again. Or for what seems like a very long time. After that, he was in my dreams nearly every night, but always on the periphery, never within reach. The month that followed the accident was uneasy, tense, and at first, embarrassing. To my dismay, I found myself the center of attention for the rest of the week. Taylor Crowley was impossible, following me around, obsessed with making amends to me somehow. I tried to convince him what I wanted more than anything else was for him to forget all about it. Especially since nothing had actually happened to me. But he reminded, insistent, he followed me between classes and sat at our now crowded lunch table. Mike and Eric was even less friendly towards him than they were to each other, which made me worry that I could gain another unwelcome fan. No one seems to concern about Edward, though I explained over and over that he was the hero, how he had pulled me out of the way and had nearly been crushed too. I tried to be convincing. Jessica, Mike, Eric, and everyone else always commented that they had not even seen him there till the van was pulled away. I wondered to myself why no one else had seen him standing so far away before he was suddenly impossibly saving my life. Within charging, I realized the probable cause. No one else was as aware of Edward as I always was. No one else watched him the way I did. How pitiful. Edward was never surrounded by crowds of curious bystanders eager for us. First-hand account, people avoided him as usual. The Cullens and the Hells sat at the same table as always, not eating, talking, only among themselves. None of them, especially Edward, glanced my way anymore. When we sat next to me in class, as far from me as the table could allow, he seemed totally unaware of my presence. Only now and then, when his whiskers wound suddenly ball up, skin stretched even whiter over the bones. Did I wonder if he was not quite as obvious as he appeared? He wished he had not pulled me from the path of the tailor's van. There was no other conclusion I could come to. I wanted very much to talk to him, and the day after the accident, I tried. The last time I could see him outside the ER, we had both been so furious. I was still angry that he could not trust me with the truth, even though I was keeping my part of the bargain flawlessly. But he had, in fact, saved my life, no matter how he could done it. And overnight, the heat of my anger faded into awed gratitude. He was already seated when I got to biology, looking straight ahead. I sat down, expecting him to turn towards me. He showed no sign that he realized I was there. "Hello, Edward," I said pleasantly to show him I was going to behave myself. He turned his head a fraction towards me without meeting my gaze, nodded once, and then looked the other way. And there was the last contact I could had with him, though he was there a foot away from me every day. I watched him sometimes, unable to stop myself from a distance through in the cafeteria or parking lot. I watched as his golden eyes grow dark day by day. But in class, I gave no more notice that he existed than he showed towards me. I was miserable, and the dreams continued. Despite my outright lies, the tenor of my emails altered Ren to my depression, and she called a few times, worried. I tried to convince her it was just the weather and that had me down. Mike, at least, was pleased by the obvious coolness between me and my lab partner. I could see he could be worried that Edward's daring rescue might have impressed me, and he was relieved that it seems to have the opposite effect. He grew more confident, sitting on the edge of my table to talk before biology class started, ignoring Edward as completely as he ignored us. The snow washed away for good. After the one dangerous icy day, Mike was disappointed he could never gotten to stage his snowball fight, but pleased that the beach trip could soon be possible. The rain continued heavily, though, and the weeks passed. Jessica made me aware of another event looming on the horizon. She called the first Tuesday of March to ask my permission to invite Mike to the Girls' Choice Spring Dance in 2 weeks. Are you sure you don't mind? You were not planning to ask him? She persisted when I told her I don't mind in the least. No, Jess, I'm not going. I assured her dancing was glaringly outside my range of abilities. It will be fun, her attempt to convince me was half-hearted. I suspected that Jessica enjoyed my inexplainable popularity more than my actual campaigning. You have fun with Mike, I encouraged. The next day, I was surprised that Jessica was not her usual gushing self in trigonometry and Spanish. She was silent as she walked by my side between classes, and I was afraid to ask her why. If Mike had turned her down, I was the last person she could want to tell. My fears were strengthened during lunch when Jessica sat as far from Mike as possible, chatting animatedly with Eric. Mike was unpleasantly quiet. Mike was still as quiet as he walked me to class, the uncomfortable look on his face a bad sign. But he don't broach the subject until I was in my seat and he was perched on my desk. As always, I was electrically aware of Edward sitting close enough to touch, as distant as if he were merely as invitation of my imagination. So, Mike said, looking at the floor, Jessica asked me to spring dance. That's great. I made my voice bright and enthusiastic. You will have a lot of fun with Jessica. Well, he frowned as he examined my smile, clearly not happy with my response. I told her I had to think about it. Why could you do that? I let the disapproval color my tone, though I was relieved he had not given her an absolute no. His face was bright red as he looked down again. Pity shocked my resolve. I was wondering if you might be planning to ask me. I paused for a moment, hating the wave of guilt that swept through me, but I saw from the corner of my eyes Edward had turned reflective in my direction. Mike, I think you should tell her yes, I said. Did you already ask someone? Did Edward notice how Mike's eyes flickered in his direction? No, I assured him. I'm not going to dance at all. Why not? Mike demanded. I don't want to get into the safety hazard that dancing presented. So I quickly made new plans. I'm going to Seattle that Saturday, I explained. I needed to get off the town anyway. It was suddenly the perfect time to go. Cannot you go some other weekend? Sorry, no, I said. So you should not make Jess wait any longer. It's rude. Yeah, you're right, he mumbled and turned dejected to walk back to his seat. I closed my eyes and pressed my fingers to my temples, trying to push the guilt and sympathy out of my head. Mr. Banner began talking. I sighed and opened my eyes, and Edward was staring at me curiously, that same familiar edge of frustration, even more distance now in his black eyes. I started back, surprised, expecting him to look away quickly. But instead, he continued to gaze with probing intensity into my eyes. There was no question of me looking away. My hands started to shake. Mr. Cullen, the teacher called, seeking the answer to a question that I had not heard. The kept cycle, Edward answered, seeing reclined as he turned to look at Mr. Banner. I looked down at my book as soon as his eyes released me, trying to find my place. Covertly as ever, I shifted my hair over my right shoulder to hide my face. I could not believe the rush of emotion pulsing through me just because he could happen to look at me for the first time in a half dozen weeks. I could not allow him to have this level of influence over me. It was pathetic. More than pathetic, it was unhealthy. I tried very hard to not be aware of him for the rest of the hour, and since that was impossible, at least not to let him know I was aware of him when the bell rang at last. I turned my back to him, gathering my things, expecting him to leave immediately as usual. Bella, his voice should not have been so familiar to me, as if I could known the sound of it all my life, rather than for the just a few short weeks. I turned slowly, unwillingly. I don't want to feel what I know I could feel when I looked into his too perfect face. My expression was wary when I finally turned to him. His expression was unreadable. He don't say anything. What? Are you speaking to me again? I finally asked, an unintentional note in my voice. His lips twitched, fighting a smile. No, not really, he admitted. I closed my eyes and inhaled slowly through my nose, aware that I was gritting my teeth. He waited. Then, what do you want, Edward? I asked, keeping my eyes closed. I was easier to talk to him coherently that way. I'm sorry, he sounded sincere. I have been very rude, I know, but it is better this way, really. I opened my eyes. His face was very serious. I don't know what you mean, I said, my voice guarded. It is better if we are not friends, he explained. Trust me. My eyes narrowed. I heard that before. It is too bad. You don't figure that out earlier. I hissed through my teeth. You could have said yourself all this regret. Regret? The word and my tone, obvious, caught him off guard. Regret for what? For not just letting that stupid van squeeze me? He was astonished. He stared at me in disbelief. When he finally spoke, he almost sounded mad. You think I regret saving your life? I know you do, I snapped. You don't know anything. He was definitely mad. I turned my head sharply away from him, clenching my jaw against all the wild accusation I wanted to hurl at him. I gathered my books together, then stood and walked away to the door. I meant to sweep dramatically out of the room, but of course I caught the toe of my boot on the door jamb and dropped my books. I stood there for a moment, thinking about leaving them. Then I signed and bent to pick them up. He was there. He already started them into a pile. He handed them to me, his face hard. Thank you, I said easily. His eyes narrowed. You're welcome. He retreated. I straightened up swiftly, turned away from him again and stalked off to gym without looking back. Gym was brutal. We could move on to the basketball. My team never passed me the ball, so that was good, but I fell down a lot. Sometimes I took people with me. Today, I was worse than usual because my head was so filled with Edward. I tried to concentrate on my feet, but he kept creeping back into my thoughts just when I really needed my balance. It was a relief, as always, to leave. I almost ran to the trunk. There was just so many people I wanted to avoid. The truck had suffering only minimal damage in the accident. I could have to replace the taillights, and if I could had a real paint job, I could have touched that up. Taylor parents had to sell their vans for parts. I almost had a stroke when I rounded the corner and saw a tall, dark figure leaning against the side of my truck. Then I realized it was Eric. I started walking again. Hey, Eric, I called. Hi, Bella. What's up? I said as I was unlocking the door. I was not paying attention to the uncomfortable edge in his voice, so his next word took me by surprise. I was just wondering if you could go to the spring dance with me? His voice broke on the last word. I thought it was girl's choice, I said, too startled to be diplomatic. Well, yeah, he admitted. Shamefaced, I recovered my composure and tried to make my smile warm. Thank you for asking me, but I'm going to be in Seattle that day. Oh, he said. Well, maybe next time. Sure, I agreed, and then bit my lip. I could not want him to take that too literally. He was off, back towards the school. I heard a low chuckle. Edward was walking past to the front of my truck, looking straight forward, his lips pressed together. I yanked the door open and jumped inside, slamming it loudly behind me. I revved the engine defiantly and reversed on into the aisle. Edward was in his car already, two spaces down, sliding out smoothly in front of me, cutting me off. He stopped there to wait for his family. I could see the four of them walking his way, but still by the cafeteria. I considered taking out the rear of his shiny Volvo, but there were too many witnesses. I looked in my rearview mirror. A line was beginning to form directly behind me. Taylor Crowley was in his recently acquired used Centena, waving. I was too aggravated to acknowledge him. While I was sitting there, looking everywhere but at the car in front of me, I heard the knock on my passenger seat door. I looked over. It was Taylor. I glanced back in my rearview mirror, confused. His car was still running, the door left open. I leaned across the cab to crank the window down. It was stiff. I got it halfway down, then gave up. I'm sorry, Taylor. I'm stuck behind Cullen. I was annoyed. Obvious. The holdup was not my fault. Oh, I know. I was just wanted to ask you something while we are trapped here. He grinned. This could not be happening. Will you ask me to the spring dance? He continued. I'm not going to be in town, Taylor. My voice sounded a little sharp. I had to remember it was not his fault that Mike and Eric had already used up my quota of patience for the day. Yeah, Mike said that. He admitted. Then why? He said, I was hoping you were just telling them down easy. Okay, it was completely his fault. Sorry, Taylor, I said, working to hide my irritation. I'm going out of town. That's cool. We still have prom. And before I could respond, he was walking back to his car. I could feel the shock on my face. I looked forward to see Aliza, Rosalie, Amity, and Jasper all sliding into the Volvo. In his rearview mirror, Edward's eyes were on me. He was unquestionably shaking with laughter, as if he could hear every word Taylor had said. My foot inched towards the gas pedal. One little bump could not hurt any of them. Just that glossy silver paint job. I revived the engine, but they were all in, and Edward was speeding away. I drove home slowly, carefully, and muttering to myself the whole day. When I got home, I decided to make chicken for dinner. It was a long process, and I could keep me busy. While I was simmering the onions and chilies, the phone rang. I was almost afraid to answer it, but it might be Charlie or my mom. It was Jessica, and she was jubilant. Mike had caught her after school to accept her invitation. I celebrated with her briefly while I stood. She had to go. She wanted to call Angelina and Lurian to tell them. I suggested with casual innocence that maybe Angelina, the shy girl who had biology with me, could ask Eric. And Lurian, a standoffish girl who had always ignored me at the lunch table, could ask Taylor. I heard he was still available. Just thought that was a great idea. Now that she was so sure of Mike, she actually sounded sincere when she said she wished I could go to dance. I gave her my Seattle excuse. After I hung up, I tried to concentrate on dinner, dicing the chicken especially. I don't want to take another trip to the emergency room, but my head was spinning, trying to analyze every word Edward had spoken today. What did he mean? It was better if we were not friends. My stomach twisted as I realized what he must have meant. He must see how absorbed I was by him. He must not want to lead me on, so he could not be even be friends because he was not interested in me at all. Of course, he was not interested in me, I thought angrily, my eyes stinging, a delayed reaction to the onions. I was not interesting. And he was interesting and brilliant and mysterious and perfect and beautiful and possibly able to lift full-sized vans with one hand. Well, that was fine. I could leave him alone. I could get through my self-imposed sentence here in and then hopefully some school in the Southwest or possibly Hawaii could offer me a scholarship. I focused my thoughts on sunny beaches and palm trees as I finished the chicken and put them in the oven. Charlie seemed so suspicious when he came home and smelled the green peppers. I could not blame him. The closest edible Mexican food was probably in Southern California, but he was a cop. Even if I just a small town cop, so he was brave enough to take the first bite. He seems to like it. It was fun to watch as he slowly began to trusting me in the kitchen. Dad, I asked when he was almost done. Yeah, Bella. I just wanted to let you know that I'm going to Seattle for the day a week from Saturday. Is that okay? I don't want his permission. It's set a bad precedent, but I felt rude, so I tackled it on the end. Why? He sounded surprised, as if he were unable to imagine something that folks could not offer. Well, I wanted to get few books. The library here is pretty limited. And maybe look at some clothes. I had more money than I was used to having since, thanks to Charlie, I had not had to pay for a car. Not the truck don't cost me quite a bit in the gas department. The truck probably does not get very good gas mileage, he said, echoing my thoughts. I know. I will stop in Montana and Olympia and Tacoma if I have to. Are you going all by yourself? He asked, and I could not tell if he was suspicious. I had a secret boyfriend or just worried about car trouble. Yes. Seattle is a big city. You could get lost. He frittered. Dad, Phoenix is 5 times the size of Seattle, and I can read a map. Don't worry about it. Do you want me to come with you? I tried to be craftable. I hide my horror. That's all right, Dad. I will probably just be in dressing rooms all day. Very boring. Oh, okay. The thought of sitting in women's clothes stores for any period of time immediately put him off. Thanks, I said to him. Will you be back in the time for the dance? Gross. Only in a town this small could a father know when the high school dances were. No, I don't dance, Dad. He, of all people, should understand that I don't get my balance problems. My mother. He did understand. Oh, that's right, he realized. The next morning, when I pulled into the parking lot, I was deliberately parked as far as possible from the silver oval. I don't want to put myself in the path of too much temptation and end up owing him a new car. Getting out of my cab, I fumbled with my key and I fell into a puddle at my feet. As I bent to get it, a white hand flashed out and grabbed it before I could. I jerked upright. Edward Cullen was right next to me, leaning casually against my truck. How did you do that? I asked in amazed irritation. Do what? He held my key out of as he spoke. As I reached for it, he dropped it into my palm. Appeared out of the thin air? Bella, it was not my fault if you are exceptionally unobservant. His voice was quiet as usual, velvet, muted. I scowled at his perfect face. His eyes were light again today, a deep golden honey color. Then I had to look down to resemble my now tangled thoughts. Why the traffic jam last night? I demanded, still looking away. I thought you were supposed to be pretending I don't exist. Not irritating me to death. That was for Taylor's sake, not mine. Had to give him a chance. He snickered. You. I gasped. I could not think of bad enough word. I felt like the heat of my anger should physically burn him, but he only seems to be more amused. And I'm not pretending you don't exist, he continued. So, you're trying to irritate me to death. Since Taylor's van don't do the job. Anger flashed in his torn eyes. His eyes pressed into a hard line, all signs of humor gone. Bella, you're utterly abused, he said. His low voice cold. My palms tingled. I wanted so badly to hit something. I was surprised at myself. I was usually a non-violent person. I turned my back and started to walk away. Wait, he called. I kept walking, slurging angrily through the rain, but he was next to me, as easily keeping pace. I'm sorry, that was rude, he said as he walked. I ignored him. I'm not saying it. It is not true, he continued, but it was rude to say it. Anyway, why won't you leave me alone? I grumbled. I wanted to ask you something, but you sidetracked me. He chuckled. He seems to have recovered his good humor. Do you have a multiple personality disorder? I said severely. You are doing it again. I sighed. Fine then, what do you want to ask? I was wondering, a week from Saturday, you know, the day of the spring dance. Are you trying to be funny? I interrupted him, wheeling around him. My face got drenched as I looked up at his expression. His eyes were vaguely amused. Will you please allow me to finish? I bit my lip and clasped my hands together, interlocking my fingers, so I could not do anything rash. I heard you say you are going to Seattle that day, and I was wondering if you wanted a ride. That was unexpected. What? I was not sure he was getting at. Do you want a ride to Seattle? With who? I asked mostly myself, obviously. He inquired every syllable as if he were talking to someone mentally handicapped. I was still stunned. Why? Well, I was planning to go see her in the next few weeks. And to be honest, I'm not sure if your truck can make it. My truck works just fine. Thank you very much for your concern. I started to walk again, but I was too surprised to maintain the same level of anger. But can your truck make it there on one tank of gas? He matched my pace again. I don't see how this is any of your business. Stupid shiny Volvo owner. The wasting of finite resources is everything's business. Is everyone's business. Honestly, Edward, I felt a thrill go through me as I said his name and I hated it. I cannot keep up with you. I thought you don't want to be my friend. I said I could be better if we were not friends. Not that I don't want to be. Oh, thanks. Now that all's cleared up. Heavy scarab, I realized. I had stopped walking again. We were under the shelter of the cafeteria roof now, so I could more easily look at his face, which certainly don't help my clarity of thoughts. It could be more prudent for you not to be my friend, he explained, but I'm tired of trying to stay away from you, Bella. His eyes were glorious, intense as he uttered the last sentence, his voice mooring. I could not remember how to breathe. Will you go with me to Sita? He asked, still intense. I could not speak yet, so I just snorted. He smiled briefly and then his face became serious. You really should stay away from me, he warned. I will see you in class. He turned abruptly and walked back to the way we could come.